In this video, I'll show you how to edit an entire video project right here within Insta360 Studio. And yes, that includes editing, reframing 360 videos, adding music, text and transitions, and most other things you'll need to edit a video from start to finish without ever opening up Premiere Pro or DaVinci Resolve. If that sounds useful, then you'll definitely want to stay to the end. And if you've ever struggled to come up with creative 360 shots that look awesome when reframed, my 360 Video 101 course is packed with ideas, inspiration, and step-by-step walkthroughs to help you film 360 content that stands out every time. You can learn more by following the link below. Now let's edit, and the first step is going to be downloading the latest version of Insta360 Studio. If you're not sure which the latest one is, it should automatically prompt you to update when you open the software next. You'll just want to make sure you're at version 5.7.0 or later. Now I'll assume at this point that you're already somewhat familiar with Insta360 Studio, so I won't bore you with the basics. However, something I do want to draw your attention to is the difference between media and project here at the top of the software. So normally when you're editing shots one by one, you'd be doing so here in the media section, but that's not what we're doing here, since our goal is to combine multiple clips together into one bigger, longer video edit. So to do that, we're going to head over to the project page, and here the software will prompt you to start a new project. So go ahead and give it a name. Choose your aspect ratio, which will likely be 16:9 if you're editing a regular video. Otherwise, you can change it to any of these ones here if you're editing for another format. You can choose your frame rate here, so choose whatever you want your project to be. If you're not sure, just leave it on auto match. Finally, under performance, if you know you're editing with a slow computer, this is where you'll want to turn proxies on and choose either 720p or 480p if you're working with a prehistoric computer. If you're not though, leave that off and go ahead and click confirm. Now, before we get started, I just want to say a big thanks to Insta360 for sponsoring this video, and all shots I'm about to edit in this video were shot with the Insta360 X5, which I'll link below. Okay, so here we have our video editing interface here on the project page, and our first step is going to be importing the files from your SD card. Now you may be met with this window when you open up Insta360 Studio, and it's basically prompting us to import the files from our SD card. So if you want access to all your video files to sort through, then you want to click import all. Otherwise, you could just handpick a few. And here they've shown up in our project media bin. This refers to files that are currently within the project we're editing, whereas temporary media refers to anything that you've imported to the previous media page. So if you have reframed a shot over there, it should show up here. Then finally, general media is where you can import any kind of video, photo, or audio file. And yes, that includes footage that wasn't shot on Insta360 cameras. As you saw by the opening of this video, I was able to successfully import footage shot on my Sony mirrorless camera. So if you have A-roll or B-roll from anywhere else, you can import it and edit it right here in Insta360 Studio. But for now, we're going to leave it here on project media, which is where all the SD card files are. Now let's take a quick tour of our editing interface. So here on the left, obviously we have our video files. To preview one, just double click it and it will show up here in the viewer. And this viewer window is interactive, so similar to the media page, you can move around to change the perspective as well as zooming in and out. You can change the aspect ratio here. You can view your video in full screen and interact with it there. Take a screenshot as well as set your in and out points. Down the bottom here, however, you'll find the project timeline, and we haven't yet imported anything to our timeline. So to do so, choose your first clip that you want to import, click and drag it down, and you'll see it's been added, and we can now scroll through it to see what it looks like. So at the very start of your project, you'll want to go through your footage and choose the best takes, and then go ahead and import them to your timeline. So I'm going to add this one here. And one more just to keep things simple. It's pretty easy to rearrange your clips. Just click and drag to change the order and it will automatically fill in the gaps. And that is thanks to this setting over here, which is the main track magnet, which essentially causes the timeline to act like a magnet. Whenever there's a gap, it will fill it in. If you turn that off, it won't fill it in. So personally, I will always keep the magnet on, as well as auto snapping, which helps in the editing process in just adjusting things to snap to certain editing points as you're going. And you want to keep preview axis off, which is a pretty annoying setting that plays the video back as you're scrolling across the timeline, which I find irritating, so I'll keep that off. Okay, so here are my three clips that I haven't reframed yet, but before I do, I'm just going to trim them a little bit to get rid of the start and end and the bits I just don't want in my final edit. So I think I wanna finish this clip around here, and there are a few ways to cut a clip. The first way is just hovering your mouse over the end of the clip, clicking and dragging it across, and because snapping's on, it will snap into place right in line with the playhead. So that's one way. Another way is pressing W on the keyboard to delete everything to the right of the playhead. So I'm going to press W now and watch this. And likewise, this will work with pressing Q as well. If you wanted to delete anything to the left of the playhead, just press Q and it will delete it. So I'm going to go ahead and trim my clips down, and that's looking good. But what if, however, you say had a longer clip that had multiple highlights within the clip, but also multiple boring bits that you wanted to cut out? Well, that's where another shortcut is going to come in handy. So let's say I wanted to cut out the middle part of this clip. While there's no button here to do this, if you consult the keyboard shortcuts here, which is this button, you'll see that there is a split function, which right now is Command or Control B. And what split is going to do is create a cut right here on the timeline. So I'll press Command B and it's made a cut. I'll go across Command B again to make another cut. And now I'll just hit delete, and that's deleted the middle section, leaving the start and end of this clip. So you could go ahead and repeat the process by hitting Command or Control B as much as you like to cut up your clips. And to undo anything, just hit Command or Control Z. Okay, so that's the basics of editing. And before we go any further, I do want to point out that Insta360 Studio is a pretty basic video editor. It's not going to be on the level of Premiere Pro or DaVinci Resolve in terms of the overall editing capabilities, but it does have all the basics that beginners need to edit a video. It's worth noting that it only has one single video track, one single audio track, and one single text track. So unfortunately, you can't do multi-track editing, at least yet. Maybe they'll add it in the future, fingers crossed. But now I want to show you my super simple workflow that will still work despite the simplicity of this program. All right, so it's time to reframe. And if you click on a clip here on the timeline, you'll find the reframing controls are in a slightly different position to where they are over on the media page. However, the same options will still be there. So if we go to the start of our clip, we would reframe in a very similar way. So to add our first keyframe, we choose the position that we like. And down here, you'll see there's an add keyframe button, which you can press. Or an alternative to that is whenever you're readjusting the viewpoint, you can add a keyframe by right-clicking on your mouse as you're doing it. So I'm clicking now, and as you can see, this yellow plus icon has showed up. So as soon as I let go, like so, it will add a keyframe automatically here on our timeline. So as I play my timeline forward by tapping the space bar and changing my perspective to keep myself in the center of frame, all I'm going to do is just right-click the mouse to add a keyframe and repeat the process. I'll pause it there, change the perspective, right click to add a keyframe. And now when we go back and rewatch this, you'll see that all of our keyframes are now locked into place. If you want to edit a keyframe, just click on it down here on the timeline. And if you want more granular control, you'll see up here at the top right, you'll find a bunch of different parameters that you can change. If you want your shot to look less fisheye, you can change this one, as well as changing the tilt and pan. And there are a few different settings here you can play with as well, all of which are different combinations of these factors here. And since we are hovering over this keyframe right now, it will automatically save this in place. However, if we move forward and say started editing with these controls, you'll see as soon as we do so, it's going to add another keyframe automatically, which is helpful. So keyframing is my personal favorite method of reframing because it allows you the most amount of control control, and keyframing just softens the movements nicely compared to the automatic reframing. However, I'll still show you the automatic reframing just so you can see it. So let's say we want this perspective to be locked on me. Well, if we click this icon here, we can activate deep track, and you'll see by this green box that it's identified me as the subject. So if I click that, it will start tracking me throughout this clip. And once it's done, it will automatically reframe me so I'm in the dead center of frame. So those are the two ways to reframe. So go ahead and choose whichever one you most like. Personally, I like manually keyframing, as I mentioned. So if you're a perfectionist like me, then you'll definitely want to keyframe. By the way, if you want to get rid of your deep track, it's pretty easy. All you need to do is have your clip selected, and then over here on the right, click delete deep track. If you want to change the speed of a clip, you'll notice this lightning bolt icon. So with your clip selected, I'm going to click that. And then here, there are options to either slow the clip down all the way down to 0.125 times, or under the fast menu, you can go up to 64 times. Most clips will look good at 16 times speed, but definitely try a few out to see which suits your clip best. And by the way, to zoom in on your timeline, just hit Command or Control Plus. And as you can see, that's zoomed in nice and close so we can edit the finer details. And to zoom out, just hit Command or Control and Minus. Now, if you are manually keyframing, your shots aren't always automatically going to be smooth when you're transitioning from one perspective to another. Sometimes it can look a bit jarring when you do it too quickly, or there's too big of a change between the two viewpoints. And this is where keyframe transitions comes in. So you'll see here on the right hand side, it says keyframe transition. And that's because I've got the playhead placed right in between my two keyframes here. And here you'll see a few different presets. These are essentially animations of movement that will soften the start and end of this movement. So if you click one, it will add it, and you can play it back to see the result. That one was pretty good, but let's try this one, slip in, slip out, see if it's any better or worse. No, I do not like that one. Fade in, fade out worked much better, so I'm going to keep it. Now, really quick, I want to talk about audio. So if you shot your footage with no intention of using the in-camera audio, it's very easy to mute it. So here on the timeline, you'll see this white line at the bottom of all of your clips. And underneath the white line, you'll see a very small mountain of waveforms. These represent the audio levels that have been recorded. So if you click and drag that white line down, you can mute your clip. Likewise, if you drag it up, you can turn the volume up. So with these clips here, I definitely want to mute them. So I'm going to go ahead and drag these audio levels down to zero. And now the clips will play over silence, because now I'm going to import a music track. And while Insta360 Studio does have an inbuilt library of music here, which you can use if it's a personal project, however, I've noticed that some creators have had their videos flagged on YouTube for using the inbuilt music in the Insta360 mobile and desktop apps. So feel free to use them if you want. Otherwise, you can drag in another track of your own. So I've got one here from Epidemic Sound that I'm going to click and drag into my project. And this now lives here on the music layer. So I'm going to drag that across. So it starts at the very start of my clip. You'll see this white line here. This is where you can lower the music so it's not too loud. I'll play it back to see how it sounds. Yep, that's pretty good. I'm going to go to the end and trim it by pressing W on the keyboard. And you'll notice there's this white marker at the end. If you click and drag that, this will add a fade to the music. So you can drag this across and you'll see that it's created a natural fade where our music is going to fade out slowly. And with your music track selected, you'll also see here at the top right is where you can manually drag the volume levels as well to get a bit finer control, as well as adding fade fade-ins and fade-outs here, which are essentially the same thing as these white handles. Now, the next thing across here is text. And again, here you'll find a library of text effects, all of which are pretty modern and shouldn't get flagged for copyright. If you want to add one, just click the yellow plus and it will add it wherever your playhead sits. And you can just drag it across like this. Now you've got the option to move it around and resize it, as well as changing the text to whatever you want. Here we go, Mr. Ben, that looks good. Might move that here into the middle, resize it, and let's watch this back. Nice. So feel free to have a play with these text animations. I noticed that they're all pretty niche specific and have a lot of animations in them, which will sometimes be helpful if you want things like location stickers. However, if you don't, I'd recommend scrolling to the bottom and choosing this one here that says journey, and I'm going to drag that on. And let's say we wanted the most simple text graphic ever with a really basic animation. Well, here on the right hand side, I'm going to delete the second text and only have the first text, where I'll write my message. I'll move it here in the viewer to the spot I want it. And then here down in the timeline as well, you can click and drag to change the length of the animation. The next one across here at the top left is transitions. And again, you've got a library of great transitions you can apply to your footage. Some of these are specific to 360 footage, and some of them can be used with any kind of footage. To add a transition, just click and drag it on top of the transition point between two clips. You can also grab the edges of this transition to shorten it or lengthen it, and then play it back to see what it looks like. If you want to try a different one, just drag it on top of the previous transition. Now, finally, I want to point out the top right hand menu. So with our clip selected, if we head over to image, here is where you'll find all of the various settings that you would have found on the media page to do with stitching, as well as if you're using any accessories, or if you want to turn direction lock on, as well as tilt recovery or jitter restoration. But in most cases, you won't need any of these. Then next to image is audio. Again, this is where you'll find your audio settings, as well as some basic denoise filters, but I'm going to keep that off. And then finally, there's adjust, which is color correction. So with the clip selected down here on the timeline, I'm going to drag the vibrance slider up, which will increase the colors while also not oversaturating them. I'm going to drag my shadows up a little bit and my highlights down, and maybe the contrast up just a tad. And that's looking pretty good. To see it before and after, just toggle this slider. There's before, there's after. Nice. So now you can go ahead and repeat this with each of your clips. Now, once you're happy with your final edit, as you can see, I've got my three clip edit here on the timeline with music added, a text graphic, a speed adjustment, as well as color correction. So now all there is left to do is export. So up the top right here, if you click export, I'd recommend changing the encoding format to H.265 with a bitrate of 100. Then choose either 1080p or 4K if you want 4K. Choose a save location, give your clip a name, and hit export. And we're done. We've just edited a video from start to finish without using an actual video editor right here in Insta360 Studio. Again, these edits might be a bit on the basic side, but sometimes that's really all you need, in which case you would follow the workflow I just showed you. Now, if you want to go beyond basic editing and start creating amazing 360 videos that look cinematic, inside my 360 Video 101 course, I'll show you exactly how to do that step by step based on my 10 years experience using Insta360 cameras. The course also comes with a lifetime access to my private 360 Creator Community Facebook group, where you can ask any questions you have and get inspiration from other 360 creators. If that sounds good, then you can learn more by following the link below. Now, if you want to dive a bit deeper into the color correction section of Insta360 Studio, in this video here, I'll show you how to make your shots look cinematic using simple sliders of the software without needing to go to DaVinci Resolve or any other editor if you don't want to.